Salam world, I'm a shorter than average girl from down under, and today we're going to look at one of the most mature cartoons that I've ever seen, Disney's The Hunchback of Notre Dame. So The Hunchback of Notre Dame is a novel written by the French author Victor Hugo. Yeah, the same guy who wrote Les Mis. Now, I haven't personally read the novel, given that it has a few themes that I personally choose to avoid when picking my literature. But from the research that I've done, there's a lot of censorship and changes that have taken place for the movie to become more kid-friendly. Despite those changes, I still think there's a lot in the Disney adaptation which isn't so kid-friendly. I still appreciate the story that the movie and the book are trying to tell. And I think that the themes that are presented are still relevant today. As an adult, I can appreciate these things, but as a kid, So today we're going to be talking about these heavier themes, trying to figure out what the message is. But if you're only here for the movie review, please click on the time shown on the screen right now, or the timestamp in the description, whichever suits you best. But for now, let's talk stories. Starts with a group of Roma being snuck into Paris when they are ambushed by Judge Frollo and his guard. A Roma couple is holding a bundle and Frollo thinks that they have stolen something, so there ends up being a huge chase and confrontation. The couple unfortunately don't make it and the bundle ends up being a baby. However, when Frollo looks at this baby, he thinks it's monstrous and tries to drop it down a well. But then the High Priest of Notre Dame comes out and tells Frollo that he needs to make up for the blood that he has shed in this holy place and raise the boy as his own. And so 20 years later, we have this poor sheltered boy, Quasimodo, living in Notre Dame as the bell ringer, not knowing what the real world feels like, and no one from the real world knowing him. The only human interaction he's ever had is with his master Frollo that teaches him that he's a monster, ugly, and that no one would want him except for him. And so Frollo forbade Quasimodo from ever leaving the bell tower for his own safety. But on the day of the Festival of Fools, Quasimodo decides to go down and enjoy the festivities. Unfortunately for him, his low profile is exposed when he was crowned the ugliest face in all of Paris. This infuriated Frollo, and so he encouraged the abuse that Quasimodo was receiving from the people. But then this young Roma dancer, Esmeralda, comes up on stage and helps him out. By doing this, she was directly opposing the authority of Frollo, which made her the center of attention. And the romantic interests of all three, Quasimodo, Frollo, and General Phoebus. But still, she had humiliated Frollo, so he needed her captured. And so she takes sanctuary inside the Cathedral of Notre Dame. Here she befriends Quasimodo and he helps her escape without the guard knowing so that she can go and live her happy and free life. But when Frollo finds out that somehow Esmeralda had escaped, he is fuming, arresting any Roma that he meets, burning down all of Paris, including some people. And this is where, like, General Phoebus draws a line and says, can't have this anymore. And when he's saving a family from a fire, Frollo orders to have him executed. And in the chase, he gets injured. Esmeralda ends up saving Phoebus and Quasimodo keeps him safe. And this is where Esmeralda confesses her love for Phoebus. Boo! Anyways, Frollo ends up putting two and two together and figures out that Quasimodo helped Esmeralda escape. So he goes and gives Quasimodo a visit, telling him that he will have Esmeralda executed the next morning. Now both Phoebus and Quasimodo go to warn Esmeralda, but only end up leading Frollo to where she is. And so Frollo captures her and gives her an ultimatum. either to marry him or to burn. Her answer was, so bye-bye, Mr. Nice Guy. Luckily, Quasimodo frees her and claims sanctuary on her behalf. But did Frollo give a damn? No, he wanted that girl out of the picture whether God wanted it or not. So he storms Notre Dame with his men, and this is when General Phoebus frees himself and the Roma, and the battle ensues. When Quasimodo and Frollo come face to face, this is when Frollo decides to tell Quasimodo the truth about his mother, and then falls to his death. The movie ends happily with people cheering for Esmeralda, Phoebus, and Quasimodo. A classic ending to a Disney movie, but it couldn't be further than the true and tragic ending of Victor Hugo's novel. I mean, in the same Les Mis fashion, not a single character comes out unscarred, and well, no single character is innocent either. The tale that Hugo tells doesn't portray the Roma as the good guys and Frollo as the bad guys. It doesn't portray Phoebus as a hero, but actually a villain, and it doesn't make Quasimodo or Esmeralda pure. Each character has a flaw and imperfection. But what makes a difference between a decent person and a monster is how much one understands their own imperfection and aims not to let it fester inside them. This theme is also discussed in the movie, but the changes in the characters definitely gives this a more black and white feel, rather than allowing the audience to decipher the good and the bad from the ambiguous and grey characters all around. I don't want to focus too much on the novel, given that I haven't read it myself, but I'm going to try and summarize the plot so that the ambiguity in the characters can become more obvious. First, we start with a mother and her baby. The baby girl is abducted by the Roma and switched with a monstrous looking boy. The mother believes that her baby girl has been
cannibalized
by the gypsies and so despises them. She ends up taking this baby boy to Paris and abandons him on the steps of Notre Dame, where he is picked up by the archdeacon Claude Frollo. So already the lens of the good guy and bad guy are flipped, with the Roma being the judgmental kidnappers and Frollo being the compassionate and religious man. The girl is raised by the Roma and is now the 16-year-old Esmeralda, whereas the boy is the hunchback and deaf bell ringer Quasimodo. So when the Roma roll back into Paris and the main attraction is Esmeralda, you bet that stirred some attention, particularly from Phoebus and Frollo. But unlike the movie, Esmeralda doesn't humiliate anyone in the Festival of Fools, nor is there a chase. Instead, Frollo enlists Quasimodo to kidnap Esmeralda. First, Quasimodo is caught in 4K by the poet Pierre, but he knocks him out, and then he is caught by General Phoebus. Quasimodo is flogged and humiliated in public, and no one would help him, except for the 16-year-old Esmeralda, who ends up giving him some water. And this makes him fall for her as well. There's this entire subplot with Esmeralda and the poet, but given that the poet doesn't even show up in the movie, it's not going to help much for the analysis, so we're just going to ignore it for now. But unfortunately for us, Esmeralda ends up falling for General Phoebus. And so you get the super messy love pentagram. Frollo finds out from Pierre that Esmeralda has fallen for Phoebus, and he gets insanely jealous. He catches them organizing a meeting in a local tavern and goes and listens to their conversation. Esmeralda thinks that Phoebus wants to marry her, but he doesn't want that kind of commitment, and so when Phoebus makes advancements, Frollo comes up and
stabs him.
Both Esmeralda and Phoebus faint, and Frollo runs away. But given that she's the only one at the crime scene, she gets framed for the attempted murder of General Phoebus. And after being tortured, she confesses to the crime, condemning herself to be hung. Frollo comes to her while she's in jail and professes his love for her, saying that he could save her if she reciprocated. Unlucky for him, she actually saw the identity of the stabber and knows exactly who he is, and so she'd rather be dead than marry a murderer. So off she goes to the execution block. There, she actually sees Phoebus in the crowd, well and okay, and calls out to him, but he just ignores her and walks into another lady's house. Like, standards. This is where the infamous scene happens, where Quasimodo swings down from Notre Dame, takes her, and claims. But in this version, Esmeralda isn't too kind to Quasimodo. She can't even look at his face because she deems him ugly, and well, they couldn't communicate because he's deaf. And although she did have sanctuary from the army, she didn't have sanctuary from Frollo. After more unwelcome advancement, Frollo makes up his mind. If he can't have her, then no one can. So he tells Pierre that Parliament is going to remove Esmeralda's right to sanctuary, and in turn, Pierre goes and tells all the Roma. The Roma decide that they're going to storm Notre Dame to rescue Esmeralda, but when they do, Quasimodo thinks they want to harm her, so he ends up fighting against them. The conflict reaches the ears of the king, who believes that the crowd wants Esmeralda executed, and so he orders his men to do so. Slimy Mr. Frollo tries his luck again, but nah, that doesn't work, so he ends up locking Esmeralda with her own mother. By the time they figured out each other's identity, the guard has come through, they're taking Esmeralda, her mom dies in the kerfuffle, and she gets executed. Quasimodo kills Frollo out of anger, and so dooms himself to live without anyone who he loves or loves him. Then years later, we find out that two skeletons embracing are found in Esmeralda's tomb, one of a young girl and one of a deformed man. So everyone lives happily ever after, Victor Hugo style. As for General Phoebus, well, Victor Hugo says that he didn't get a happy ending either, 'cause he got married. So standards. What a mess, and a mess it's intended to be. Both a social and moral story with a discussion of religion in the middle of it. It's not at all meant for a younger audience, so I'm not entirely sure why Disney decided to adapt it. Now, Disney does draw from some grim source material, pun intended. So I guess we shouldn't be too surprised, but generally they opt to remove the dark and gruely parts of the story, as you may know from watching my Snow White or Sleeping Beauty videos. But not here. Instead, Disney uses the landscape that Victor Hugo has created to tell their own story, focusing on the themes that they deem important: human imperfection, supremacy, social prejudice, and discrimination. Unfortunately, these days, these terms, they get thrown around the political sphere like kids throw balls on a playground. They've lost all their meaning and worth, to the extent that some people are sick of hearing the words because they are so frequently used out of context. In today's discussion, we aim to keep the integrity of these words, using them as precisely as possible. And I believe that this story is a great platform for that. The reason being that this story establishes an objective good in the form of religion, rather than keeping it open to subjective interpretation of what is good and what is evil, which is what makes this discussion very complex in the real world. The movie also views these issues by presenting contrasts, pitching two extremes against one another so they are easily identifiable. For our purpose, extremes make these themes a lot easier to pick out. The movie selects one bad guy, Frollo.
Duh.
Maybe the worst Disney villain ever. And then they select three other characters to be the good guys, each a complete opposite of Frollo in one of his evil natures. Frollo's contrast with Esmeralda presents the discussion on religiosity and extremism. His contrast with Quasimodo presents a discussion on the definition of monster. And his contrast with Phoebus is a discussion on equality and status. Each discussion is a whole video's worth of content, but today we'll just summarize the core of these topics, starting off with Frollo and Esmeralda. We don't get much context to Frollo's character in the Disney adaptation, but I do think that his character depiction can be a result of the backstory given to him in the novel. So I'm gonna add this context so that we can understand, not justify, his thoughts and opinions in the movie. Frollo was orphaned very young when his parents caught the plague. He also has a younger brother that he had to look after and later funded his habits. So early on, he was placed in a position where he needed to make something of himself so that he and his brother could survive. He threw himself into devout studies until he climbed the ranks of the religious and legal political authorities. For him, his power came from his discipline and rhetoric. And given that he knows his origins and his current life, then he believed that he had God on his side. For if he was doing the wrong thing, then why didn't God smite him? Why did he let him have so much? He must be good, and the path that he took must be the right path. So those who don't have what I have and don't live the way that I live, well, it must mean that they aren't as good as I am and that God has abandoned them. The best way to help them is to use my power to give them the life that I had and make them the trod the path that I did, so that maybe then they would be in the eyes of God again. Although there's another part of me that doesn't want them to have everything that I do, because then I won't be better than them, and so I won't be able to keep all my power and benefits. Instead, I'm gonna use the first thought to justify me feeling powerful over them and forcing them to live the life that I see fit for them. And so we see Frollo judging every citizen of Paris and prosecuting them if they live unholy lives. On the other hand, the Roma live nomadic, flamboyant, yet traditional lives. They enjoy the small things in life and pick freedom over control. This doesn't mean that they've abandoned God, but see God outside the confinements of the four walls of the church. As we see in Esmeralda, it means that she can see the beauty in everything, even though it's not so apparent. Because what is from God is good, and the wrong things in the world, well, they come from us humans. We also see that both Frollo and Esmeralda are confident individuals, but their confidence comes from very different places. Esmeralda's confidence comes from her hope and faith for a better world. She wants everyone to live equally and believes that this is possible because that is God's word. She has nothing to fear. If this isn't the time for freedom, so be it. But she will continue to practice what she believes because to her, that is the right thing to do. On the contrary, Frollo's confidence stems from his narcissistic personality, not God or the church, though he deems it to be so. His power and success makes him believe that he is perfect and sinless. His drunken arrogance has reached such a state that he blames God for his own desires.
Beata Maria. Righteous man, of my virtue I am justly proud. Beata Maria, you know I'm so much purer than the common, vulgar, weak, licentious crowd. Then tell me, Maria, why I see her dancing there, why her smoldering eyes still scorch my soul. I feel her, I see her, the sun caught in her raven hair is blazing in me out of all control. It's not my fault if in God's plan he made the devil so much stronger than a man.
Essentially, he sees himself above God. The balls on this kid. And ball he has, cuz to make sure that no one knows what he did 20 years ago, Frollo hides Quasimodo in the bell tower of Notre Dame and dumps his self-esteem down the well to make sure that he never, ever tries to leave and expose his abuse to the world. And the reason why Frollo abuses Quasimodo is because he's a gypsy too. So in Frollo's eyes, sinful and beneath him. The thing that Frollo wasn't counting on is the gargoyles picking up Quasimodo's self-esteem and giving it back to him. Now, unfortunately, Quasimodo's appearance is what makes people think that he's a monster. But through Quasimodo's journey, he finds out that the only people who treat him differently are Frollo and the King's Guard, meaning that the problem isn't with him, but them. The contrast between the outer monster and the inner monster makes the audience reflect on the true criteria of monstrosity: actions. Frollo is a monster because he acts like a monster. He acts in an ugly way and a frightening way. Quasimodo, on the other hand, looks different but acts normally with kindness and compassion. Yes, he has the tendency to be reserved and cynical, but who can blame him? The only person he'd ever met was this guy. When Quasimodo eventually met other people, he started to realize that they're not at all as bad as he has been told. But his gratitude for the small things that he did have made it impossible for him to go against Frollo. He just doesn't agree with him anymore, which in normal circumstances would be a good sign for his mental maturity and becoming independent. But for Frollo, not. How dare Quasimodo disobey him? The blasphemy. Again.
God complex.
Which is the same complex which makes him feel entitled to have Esmeralda. The conclusion to the movie and what happens to Quasimodo just reflects the imperfection of humanity. When someone treats him kindly, then the crowd treats him kindly. But when someone disrespects him, so does the crowd. Humans can be weak, and so we opt to follow behind someone and hide in the crowd. Yet, Esmeralda didn't because she's a strong individual. However, despite her strength or lack of judgment, Esmeralda picks Phoebus over Quasimodo at the end, showing that even kindness has its limits, as humans will never really abandon their own wishes for someone else. Which isn't a bad thing. I mean, Esmeralda has the right to pick whoever she wants to pick. But it's the reality of life. People aren't gonna do everything for you out of kindness. You have to do some things for yourself as well. Speaking of which, both Phoebus and Frollo were enchanted by Esmeralda's routine in the Festival of Fools, but the way they go about expressing their interests are vastly different. Phoebus introduces himself and wishes to prove his worth to Esmeralda, aka he wants her to choose him. When that doesn't work, he respects her wishes and moves on with his life, despite still caring for her. Frollo was like, God, if you don't make her mine alone, then she'll be damned. So choose wisely, God. And then proceeds to capture her, burn her, and do everything but respect her wishes and her right to live her own life. Because in his eyes, they're not equal, and so he doesn't have to treat her in that particular way. In short, Frollo's quarrel with Esmeralda stems from him not seeing her as an equal in humanity. Whether that be because she's a gypsy or a girl or unreligious, whatever. He deems his status as God-given, and so he must be better than her. Not being able to admit to his own lust, he convinces himself that God wants to save Esmeralda through him, and so he must have her or she's doomed to hell. Essentially, he's claiming supremacy over her and her people, Which lengths to his attitude to Quasimodo as well, as he discriminates from anyone who is different. Phoebus is the complete opposite of Frollo in this regard. He shows us how we should act when it comes to standing up against tyranny and respecting all people as equals. So, quick summary. Frollo attributes his superiority to God and so gives himself a jail-free card for everything he does because God's on his side. Esmeralda, who societally lives as a religious outcast, actually acts more religiously because she values life over status. And the movie highlights this and Frollo and Esmeralda's relationship to religion through their songs
God help the outcasts.
and
Hellfire.
Quasimodo is portrayed as a monster due to his condition, which gives him a unique appearance. But Frollo is the true monster due to his selfishness and the actions he justifies for himself. And the movie presents Phoebus as what Frollo should have been if he was a decent person. Yeah, so this movie has a lot of adult themes which are disguised as kid friendly. As an adult that understands these themes, I think they're a bit too much for the innocence of kids. It's not something that I would recommend for children at all, and it's something that someone could potentially explore when tweens are starting to lose their innocent view of the world. It does package a lot of the harshest crevices of humanity into a neat story, so I do give them that. It's ruthless, it's harsh, and its happy ending just isn't satisfying. Which some may say it summarizes the real world. Again, I just want to point out that there was a lot that I could have discussed but didn't just because of time, but I hope this still gave you a good idea of what to expect when walking into this movie or this novel. And that was the tragic tale of the Hunchback of Notre Dame. If you want to watch this movie, please make sure to use a streaming platform that doesn't support the violation of human rights or the spread of negativity in the world. Share this video with anyone you think would be interested in this kind of content, and if you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on similar content. Be brave, be happy, and be kind, and we'll catch you all next time.